Body of evidence that was recounted for why we as humans need downtime. So for most of the 20th century, scientists assumed that when you're not actively thinking about a particular problem, that your brain was largely offline. And when the MRI scans were started to be applied to this issue in the early 90s, it seemed like scientists' intuitions were generally true, that blood flow through the brain appeared to become especially active during specific mental tasks. So if you were thinking about a calculus problem or reading a book. However, by the mid-1990s, researchers at Washington University in St. Louis showed that human brain activity was, in fact, actually constantly on, whether you were engaged in a particular task or just daydreaming. But more surprisingly was the observation that a particular set of scattered brain regions became consistently less active when you were concentrating on a mental challenge, but began to fire in synchrony when someone was just lying down, doing nothing more than letting their thoughts wander. Completely counterintuitive. Your brain, when it's concentrating on a particular hard calculus problem, well, there are lots of parts of it that turn off. But when you're just lying and thinking about nothing in particular, it is like a veritable fireworks going off in your brain, different regions in synchrony firing. The brain is not idle. It's actually very productive during downtime. And scientists are coming to the conclusion that this downtime, a regular downtime, is absolutely essential for developing a sense of identity, for learning appropriate social behavior, for instilling this internal sense of ethics. You need downtime. So the next time you're falling asleep at work, you can just tell your boss, I'm not daydreaming, I'm resetting my neural pathways for greater productivity and efficiency. It's scientific. We have this instinct that rest is important. And science itself is telling us rest is important. And yet, most of us don't feel particularly rested. Most of us are so busy, so tethered to our smartphones, that even on vacation, you find that buzz in your pocket and you're compelled to check. True rest that rejuvenates the mind, the heart, the spirit. It's not scientific, it's really God's idea. Science is only catching up with what God had instituted right from the beginning of creation. The Sabbath. The Sabbath is this radical test of the radical rest that we need in Christ. But it is a challenge for us to rest in this way. We know it's good for us. The instinct of our hearts tell us we crave it and need it. And yet true rest, well, it seems to elude us like sand through the fingers. It is an act of faith that the Spirit empowers and draws us into. And that's why we choose to be here together. We choose right now, you are choosing right now to do what God, from the moment of creation, has designed you to do. To gather together as His people and to be infused in a time of resetting, so that you can in turn go out and create anew. This is the cosmic reset button that we're engaged in tonight, the Sabbath rest. It's not being unproductive. It's being infused with the life of God Himself to be truly productive as God would intend it. So I'm going to invite us, well, to metaphorically lie down and reset. Don't physically actually do it. I don't want to lose you here. But I'm going to give you a space, a half a minute of silence, and ask that you would reset your heart with God. Lord, we just collectively exhale. We seek to find our rest in you. For indeed, it is the case that we are restless until we truly find our Sabbath rest in you. It is for this purpose that you came into this world, Christ Jesus, to tell us, to invite us, to indeed command us, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. So the Sabbath is not simply about not working. That would be a vacation. That's not Sabbath. The Sabbath, in fact, is a radical test that is infused right from the get-go of creation. Now, Jesus here in this passage engages in an argument about the Sabbath because the Jews thought of the Sabbath as something far more important than just a siesta during the week or a vacation in the rhythm of life. For the Jews, the Sabbath was a test of faith and faithfulness. And that is why Jesus lays down the gauntlet of a challenge. In verse 19, "Has not Moses given you the law? Yet not one of you keeps the law. Why are you trying to kill me?" And in a moment, he will associate this question with a debate about the Sabbath. And he concludes, "Stop judging by mere appearances," in verse 24, "and make the right judgment about the Sabbath." Now, why did the Jews take Sabbath so seriously? Well, because they had an understanding that part of what got them in trouble was their refusal to stop and observe the Sabbath. The book of Isaiah excoriates the Israelites for ignoring the Sabbath. And so after the time of exile, when they had 70 years out of the promised land, they took that opportunity to reflect. And so afterwards, the Jews were scrupulous. They were very meticulous about observing the Sabbath. It was important to them because it was an expression that they had learned their lesson during the exile. And because they were so scrupulous about keeping the Sabbath during the time of Jesus became a distinguishing mark of what it meant to be a Jew. Yes, there were the kosher laws, but there were also the Sabbath-keeping habits of the Jews. You know, we're very used to a 7-day calendar week where, you know, we work for a while and then we take a break. But in the ancient world, there was no 7-day week like this. The Jews were quite unique in observing a regular day off. The Roman world had its calendars, and there were particular market days that you could take off. But they did not come at a regular cyclical 7-day pattern. In fact, many in the Roman Empire resented the Jews for observing a day off every week. It was bad for Roman business. And so the Sabbath, well, it became a marker of Jewish identity. Oh, the Jews, they're those people that take a day off every week. and the Jews became scrupulous about guarding it. They wanted to be so careful that they built what was called a hedge around this law. All sorts of extra laws just to be extra careful that they would never run into danger of breaking the Sabbath. A set of laws that would protect that one law. How far you can carry. Well, that would be determined by these extra laws. You could not carry something more than 1,000 feet, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So for the Jews, the Sabbath, it was a radical test, a test of their faith, a test of their willingness to identify with other Jews as the people of God. But underneath that was a deeper test that Jesus was calling them to. Why is Sabbath such a radical test? Because Sabbath takes something that we all need to deal with. We are not all going to be wealthy. I hate to break that to you. You're not all going to be smart and have to deal with the responsibility of stewardship of your brain. You're not all going to be Michelangelo and create the greatest works of art, and you have to be responsible with your artistic talent. That's not it. Not for all of you. But there is something that all of you will have to deal with. Time. Every single one of us, no matter how gifted or in what manner we are gifted, no matter what job we have in life or don't have, we have something that is a test for all of us, common to all of us. Time. And Sabbath takes what we need, all need to deal with, time, and turns it into a radical test of what or who rules your life. And so Jesus, he enters into this controversy in the context of authority. The conversation here of the Sabbath takes place within this larger conversation about Jesus' authority. And so the Jews in verse 15 marvel and put this question out about Jesus. The Jews were amazed and asked, how did this man get such learning without having studied? Now, this was not a question about ingenuity. You know, when I was a freshman in college and particularly lazy and just wanted to sneak by with the least amount of effort possible, I looked at a verse like this and I wanted to pray it into my life. I wanted my professor to say, how did this man get such learning without having studied? To me, it was a recipe for how do you be a genius without having to work at it. That's not what the passage is at all getting at. It is getting at where does Jesus get off on speaking like this to us? What gives him the authority to speak like this? He is not a trained rabbi. We see no degree next to his name. He is of the school of Gamaliel or Hillel or Shammai or any. We see no such thing. What gives him the authority to do this stuff on the Sabbath and to tell us that we are wrong about the Sabbath? Jesus makes the Sabbath fundamentally an issue of authority. Who is in control? Who gets to set the terms for your life? Sabbath is about our ambitions. What holds our attentions? What are the rules that we live by? In the Old Testament, the commandment in Deuteronomy about the Sabbath delineates that we are to observe the Sabbath by keeping it holy. It's this intentional, distinct act of setting aside something. Something that is normally just normal, something that's ordinarily, setting aside something or someone apart for some extraordinary purpose. You set aside something that is common so that it may be made sacred, and in turn remind you of what to do with the common. So in the Old Testament, you could make holy cups, pots, basic forks that you would use in worship. You can take ordinary people and set them aside like a shepherd to be a king. It is taking the ordinary and setting it aside for the extraordinary. Not just so that extraordinary thing can be put in a box and made separate, but in turn recognizing that God could take the most ordinary things, cups, forks, shepherds, and set them aside for extraordinary purposes solely because His Spirit has come upon them. His grace has been poured out. So what believers have done through the ages is to set aside the common thing, the thing most common to all of us, time. To set that common thing aside in a sacred moment. Not that we could just box it away and keep it confined, but so that we learn a habit. We learn to set aside one day so that we can set aside all days for God. One of the fruitful things that I would suggest you do during a Sabbath, maybe just an experiment for 4 Sabbaths, a month worth of Sabbaths. In addition to coming to worship service, take out your daily planner. On this day of rest, take out your daily planner and bring it before the Lord. Pray for your Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Pray for each day and say, Lord, I set aside this one day so that I could sanctify all my days. Take a particular meeting that you might have on a Wednesday, and on this day, bring it to the Lord. You know, when I give you these spaces of a minute of silence before or after, I mean, you can use it. Use it to bring your issues to God. As we're worshiping, bring your daily moments, your common things that you will be facing this week to God. That is Sabbath keeping. The Sabbath is about what rules us. What are the things this coming week that will threaten to rule us? That if we are not intentional and purposeful about bringing these things to God, we in fact are going to get to the end of our coming week. Next Saturday, you're going to be rolling off of your work week next Saturday, exhausted, stressed out from all the stuff that happened to you this coming week, and you're going to wonder, where on earth was God in all of this? Where did I let God get away in all of this? What rules you? And you are, in turn, to take these coming days and to set them apart for God. This is, in fact, even before the commandments in Exodus and Deuteronomy were given to the Israelites about Sabbath keeping, even before the Jews set up all these extra laws to safeguard those 2 basic laws in Exodus and Deuteronomy, in the book of Genesis, there was a model of what the Sabbath was about. It was not only a radical test of what rules us, what will occupy our time and threaten to overcome us if we are not intentional in walking with God, but it is also about what we rule, how we are exercising God's authority in and through our lives and our gifts that we offer. And so you notice how God Himself did Sabbath. 6 days He creates. First day He creates. There was night, there was day, it was good. God went to the second day. It was night and it was day, it was good. God went to the third day. On and on and on until the 7th day. And the 7th day, Scripture says, God ceases from the work of creation. Now, we have to be very, very careful here. It says that God had ceased, rested from all that He had done, all the work of creation. It does not say that God stopped working. He simply stopped working at what He had been doing for 6 days, the work of creation. He ceased that work. But that does not mean he was not working on the seventh day. He rested from one kind of work to start a different kind of work, a work of blessing and making holy. And this is what makes sense of Jesus' statement in John chapter 5. Jesus said to the Jews, "My Father is always at his work to this very day. And so too, I am working." On the seventh day, God didn't just stop. No, God engaged in a different kind of work that Jesus is talking about here. And what is that kind of work? He ceases from the work of creation to start engaging in the work of ruling, of blessing, of sustaining that creation. God created, he was fruitful, and he was multiplying all of the created order. And then in turn, he did what Adam was supposed to do. He started to subdue it, to bring it under order. He was fruitful and multiplied, and then he exercised his rule over creation, starting on day 7. And this is exactly what he calls Adam to do. Adam was to be fruitful and multiply, engage in the creative endeavor, and then in turn exercise the rule of God. Sabbath is a reminder. It's a test, not only as to who or what rules you, but it is also a reminder and an invitation to exercise God's rule in and through you. Whatever you do from your Monday through Friday work or Monday through Saturday, whatever it may be, you are engaging in this seventh day kind of work. There is a reason why at the end of the seventh day, unlike every other day has an ending to it. It was night, it was day, God said it was good. The sixth day. Every single day, except the seventh day. There is no ending. There is no, it is night, it is day, God said it was good. It's an open-ended day. Why? Because God is now inviting you into the work of helping him rule. Whatever you do, whatever your vocation is in life, whatever your gifting is within the church, it is an invitation to take up God's work from the seventh day of ruling, of sustaining. God intends you from the moment of creation to join him in blessing and making holy his creation. Frankly, most of us don't have work where that's easy to think of. It will take you sometimes a monumental effort to begin your day, to hop on the T, or to get onto 93 and to face all the chaos of commuting in Boston and to engage with what lay ahead of you as a joint endeavor with God to bring about his creative order in the cosmos. That is going to be for you a monumental act of faith to believe that that is the case. You are not going to the Prudential Center. You are not going to BU. You're not going to whatever physical therapy work and you're visiting a person's home, or you're not going to any of these things ultimately apart from the going with God in this creative work. What would it look like to this day recommit yourself to that kind of engagement? And we rest on Sabbath, not only to have the radical test of what rules us and what can we rule, but as a reminder as well, we rest to remind ourselves that it's all about redemption. A certain kind of ruling, not a ruling that wields authority over others, but humbly serves and redeems others. This is why the Sabbath command in Deuteronomy reads the way it does. Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 13, 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, Neither you, nor your son or daughter, nor your manservant or maidservant, nor your ox, nor your donkey, nor any of your animals, nor the immigrant within your gates, so that your manservant, maidservant may rest as you do. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt, and that the Lord your God brought you out of there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God has commanded you to observe the Sabbath day. The Sabbath simply wasn't an occasion for you just to stop from work, to have a little vacation, nor was it just an individual self-improvement moment to take stock of how you can exercise God's rule in the unique giftings and vocations of your lives. Here, Sabbath is given to us as a corporate redemption effort. You could not complete Sabbath unless you made sure that other people for whom you were responsible also rested. This is an amazing reminder. On the Sabbath day, what we do is to remember that we are, in fact, our brother's keepers. You cannot fully engage in the Sabbath rest unless you know that those around you are being redeemed and released to newness of life. Unless you know that those around you are being released from their slavery, whether it is a physical slavery in bondage in Egypt or slavery of the soul to sin. Sabbath is a reminder that there is a world in desperate need of redemption. In every single domain of life, including the ox and the donkey. It is the entire domain that we seek God's redemption of. This is astoundingly countercultural in the ancient world. In the ancient world, the king rested, everyone worked so that the king rested. Here, in this statement, what one British prime minister reported to have described as the first and greatest work protection act in history, that is what he called the Sabbath. It was a call to redemptive activity, that we are our brother's keeper. We are responsible. This generation of believers is responsible for this generation of the cosmos. To call one another to find forgiveness in Christ, another type of life from the rat race that they are experiencing. And so we rest. We rest to remind us that God is the one who rules our lives, and in turn, He wants to rule through our lives. We rest as a remembrance of our redemptive purposes, that God has called us to be freed from slavery, freed from the bondage of guilt, freed from our own personal ambitions, free to serve others. There should be, by the time the benediction rolls around, a lightness to your spirit that enables you to go forth with joy, to be so inspired and so equipped, to be so loved by those around you, brothers and sisters keepers, to have prayed thoughtfully about your week, and to take that thing that we all struggle with, time, and bring it to God. And in the release of our concerns, in the release of our failures to God, in the release of unmet expectations of our own lives, in letting these things go to God, we find freedom. And we walk out with joy. And we walk out eager for the joy of those sitting next to you. Man, wouldn't it be awesome that every time we worshiped, every time you passed the peace, you took a mental note of that person's face. And at some point during the worship service, you didn't just pass the peace, you prayed the peace into that person's life. You prayed something crazy like, God, whatever that person is going through, by the end of this worship service, meet them. Meet them. That they might go into this week, people ready to bring the world redemption. Man, if you had people praying like that for you, if you prayed like that for others, what could God not do in and through us? And as we do, we enter into what is now the fulfillment, the climax of Sabbath. It is not simply just remembering who rules and how he wants to rule. It's not simply this radical test of redemptive purposes that we all are to engage in. Sabbath is just the appetizer of a meal that we await and crave. It is an anticipation of the resurrection life to come. And for this reason, the church does not observe its day of Sabbath on a Saturday. The great resurrection of Jesus, that first fruit of the Sabbath rest that will extend for all of eternity, that was the defining moment. It was the beginning of the climax of history. So compelling it was that it wrapped up all the anticipation, the foreshadowing of the Old Testament practice of Sabbath keeping, wrapped it all up and moved it into another day to point our attention, not backwards to the week that just happened, but forward to the week that will happen. And so we find in the New Testament, on the first day of the week, Jesus was resurrected. On the first day of the week, believers gathered to worship. Why? Because Sabbath now is an anticipation of what is to come. It is the first day of a new creation. God is calling us. God is calling us to remember that there is, in fact, a life to come. All of us are going to have rough days, rough weeks, rough months, maybe even a rough year. This could be circumstantial. Situations, chaotic circumstances beyond your control that just come crashing in your life. And it threatens to be the most dominant view on your horizon. You lift up your eyes, and all you can see are the mountains of circumstances that seem to be surrounding you. Or you can look inward. A struggle with a particular sin that you have confessed over and over. Your self-worth, for whatever reason. And all you see are endless valleys going deeper and deeper into despondency. What Sabbath ought to be is a reminder that God has started the clock on a new eternity. And that is the most real thing about you. Not the mountain of your circumstances, not the valley of your despair. The most real thing about you, the thing that God on every Sabbath is seeking to give you a fresh vision of, is that God has now invited you to a reality of his eternity that is unfolding, yes, imperfectly in this life, but is still unfolding. And there will come a day when it will just blossom. And you will be able to say, with no postmodern sense of irony, you're going to be able to say, that was all worth it. There was no sacrifice made for Jesus. There was no sin struggle on behalf of his glory that outweighs the magnificence of what I'm seeing right now. And this is your future. God, on this day that we set aside, just taking a normal 24-hour period of our life and setting it aside for you so that we can set aside all the days of our lives, we do so. We do so in offering ourselves, yes, in offering tokens of what you have given to us, but mostly offering ourselves, our time, our ambitions, our insecurities, our circumstances, our struggles with sin. And as we offer, as we pray, and as we sing, I ask that by the time the benediction rolls around, that you would have granted to us a vision, a newness of life, a life everlasting that will press forward, that becomes for us the most dominating vision on our horizon. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Amen.